Hello friends, my name is Dr. Praful Pawar and I am from Department of Management Sciences of Savitribai Phule Pune University. Friends, today we will have a look at the course Product Management in its second module, that is Pricing Strategies. Price is an important element of the marketing mix. I hope by now you are aware about the marketing mix. That is all the four P's: product, price, place and promotion. Price is an important part of that marketing mix. It is strategically very, very important in competition, as you are aware that the most of the price competition takes place around the price. One more important aspect: price also connotes quality to the customers. Inadvertently, we tend to believe that higher the price, better is the quality of the product, and that indirectly otherwise means that price is an important proxy for quality as far as customers' perceptions are concerned. Friends, apart from all other costs and overheads, the price is an important source of revenue and profits for the firm. There are many instances where the price alone defines the market segment in which the product would operate. And since the price governs the market segment, naturally the price also decides which will be the competitors for the given product. Price is also used sometimes in short-term sales promotional efforts. That means you tend to give some discount in the short run and try to boost the sales. So in a way, we need to understand that price is a very important aspect. As far as there are many synonyms to price, though we are accustomed to hearing price as a very common word, but there are many aspects which also connote or otherwise means the price. Here I list all these aspects. One of them is rent or tuition, fee, fare, rate, toll, premium, honorarium, special assessment, bribe, dues, salary, and so on and so forth. Price has much a broader connotation. So naturally the question arises, how do we define price? When it comes to defining the price, we say price is an expression of value. That otherwise means what is the effort and the cost a customer is putting in to obtain a good product or service, and how much benefit is he deriving out of that. So the cost and the benefit put together, the difference would mean the value that is getting delivered to the customer. So we say price is an expression of the value that's being delivered. Now, how it's this value is delivered? The value is delivered through multiple areas which we have listed here. The first and foremost is usefulness and quality of the product itself. How useful the product is to my customers and how do they perceive what is the quality of the product. Second aspect is, apart from utilitarian value of the product, there is some image that we try to convey to the customers through variety of advertising and sales promotion efforts. So that means a BMW is not mere a car, it's much beyond a physical engineering machine. An image is being projected and that also delivers some value to the customers. There is third aspect: how well distributed the product is and how can we reduce the effort in obtaining the product. And that leads us to availability of the product through distribution networks. So better the distribution network, efficient the distribution network, that essentially means the product is delivering more value to at least a few customers. You know friends, in today's world, no product can be without service. It would be either before purchase of the product that the company provides you variety of information about the product. It gives you a trial run, a demonstration, a test ride, so on and so forth. Or when you obtain the product, a lot of service goes with it. We call that as after sales service. In some cases, even after the end of the stipulated life of the product, many firms help you in disposal of the product, and that disposal itself becomes a service. So when you define price and when you talk of the value that is being delivered, it will usually incorporate all these elements, including the utility of the product, the quality of the product, the image that is associated or the brand value that is associated with the product, availability of the product through distribution networks, and before sales and after sales services. So all these elements together will deliver some value to the customer. Now it's up to the seller to decide what value am I delivering and how would my customers perceive it, and that whole thing comes to be concentrated the way you fix the price. And so we say price is an expression of the value that's being delivered to the customer. How do we formally define price? So here is the definition. Price is the seller's estimate of what all of this is worth to my potential buyers, recognizing that what options do they have for the same. Friends, when you want to buy a bike, naturally you have lot many options. And now when I am going to set a price for my bike, I will have to take into consideration what options are available to you. And how would you evaluate each of the options, and how would you see value in each of the product that's available to you as an option. And therefore, in this entire comparative exercise, I will have to estimate what is the worth of my product in the eyes of the customer. Another thing, while setting this estimate, I'll have to set in such a way that my product gets sold, it finds some market. And at the same time, at the given price level, it is profitable to my firm. So it's a challenging task that the customer should get convinced with my product, he should accept my product. So the product finds market. At the same time, it shouldn't be that low that I'm barely profitable. So I need to ensure that I also generate some profits. And therefore, you will find price as a variable would always keep on floating between these two important elements, two extreme ends. The first end is the cost you incur. Look at this diagram and you will realize that this cost part is an important element. When you manufacture something, when you produce something, or when you deliver some services, either of this, in these situations you end up incurring some cost. To produce something or to deliver something, you carry out a set of activities. Each activity naturally adds some value to the process. At the same time, there can't be any activity without adding costs. So all these costs added by individual activities at a cumulative level become your total costs. Naturally, no seller would prefer to sell the product below this cost. So when I show you this line, this entire line, you will realize that on this line, the extreme, one of the extreme ends is the cost that my firm incurs. Now there is another extreme. This extreme is the customer value. Having produced goods or services, when I offer them to my customers, customer compares them, evaluates them, and then decides what's the worth. How much value is it adding to me? One thing you must keep in mind, in case of industrial products, it's relatively easier to estimate the worth. So when you procure a machine, you definitely have very clear estimates that what is the price of the machine I am required to pay on one hand, and at the same time, what kind of benefits it's delivering to me. So how efficient my production would be, leading to how much of saving. How easy it would be to operate and maintain the machine over its lifespan, and then how much would it lead to monetary savings. How better quality it would produce, and how much price premium would my customers be willing to pay for it. All these aspects become important, and therefore in case of industrial products, it's relatively easy to estimate the value that is being received by the customers. But even in case of consumer products, the customer, though not as capable as estimating the worth of the product in case of the value delivered or in terms of the value he is receiving, he may not be able to do that, but he has some reference points. So naturally, when you go to buy potato chips, you know the price points that it's sold at rupees 5 or rupees 10 or rupees 20. When you buy a chocolate, you know the price points. When you try to buy glucose biscuits, you know the price points, and naturally you will not like to exceed that price point. So at a given price point, how much value you are getting, which is a better choice, that definitely you will take into consideration, and that eventually decides the customer value, and this customer value becomes the another end. So no customer would like to pay beyond the value he is receiving. Now naturally, the price has to be somewhere between this. If a seller tries to sell the product at a price very, very close to the costs, what would happen? He would lose profits, he will not earn enough money for sustaining the business. And what if he tries to position the price near the customer value? The customer would be a loser. He will end up paying equivalent to what he is getting, leaving no benefit to him, and so he will not prefer to buy it. So you need to devise a point between these two extreme ends, where you say, here is my price and I am achieving a balance between these two variables. So the value I am creating by manufacturing goods or providing services, and that additional value I am sharing with my customers. So one thing is definitely that when you decide on price, it has to be between these two extreme ends, where you end up balancing these two parameters. When you set this price, one important dimension is what is your objective. And interestingly, for different markets and different firms and in different phases of business, the pricing objectives are different. We'll have a look in this module at various objectives when you set prices. And friends, these pricing objectives are the important starting points before you go ahead and choose a pricing method or actually fix a price or manipulate it, change it. So pricing objective is the core of the entire pricing strategy which we are going to study today. The first objective becomes, of course, survival. There are times, turbulent times, or the firm is new, or there are a lot of competitive pressures in the market. And in such situation, the sole objective of the firm becomes, how would I survive in this market? So there are many situations like overcapacity. Whatever demand is available in the market, the installed capacity is much more than the demand or the possible demand, the potential demand. Now in this situation, there would be a fierce competition, cutthroat competition, and particularly for smaller firms, particularly for non-performing firms, the objective of pricing becomes survival. And the prices are set in such a manner that the firm is barely profitable and it would survive. Another dimension, in such situations, a firm may fix its price even below costs. Why? The firm will try to avoid or reduce losses. If the product is not sold, the whole of the cost incurred becomes a loss. And in such situation, the firm would be left with no choice but to ensure that the product is sold, come so may or at whatever price. Now, in such situations, the firm may choose to set its price even below cost. And that's why it becomes interesting that what objective you are starting with, and that objective decides what your pricing strategy would be. There is second objective, that I want to maximize current profits. I'm not looking at long-term results, but today there is a boom in the market, there is a huge demand in the market, and my intention is to maximize my profitability. So here I estimate the demand associated with alternative prices. What I would do is, I will do some sort of experimentation with the prices. What if my price is price plus 1, price plus 2, or price minus 1, price minus 2? What is the price elasticity of the demand? And how would the sales vary if I change my prices? And I'll pick up that point where I get maximum current profit. Once more, I would like to repeat that pricing strategy depends on what you are trying to achieve in the market. Now, in this category, the firm is trying to maximize its profit as on today. It's not concerned much about the long-term results or long-term objectives. Look at this third objective, that I wish to maximize the market share. My objective is not to maximize profits. That doesn't mean I want to incur losses, but I want to maximize my current market penetration. My research findings suggest that there is enough of potential in the market, but somehow my firm or my competitors' firms have not reached to those customers who are currently not using this product category. So my objective at this stage is to maximize the market share, reach out to those people who are not using my products. And in such situation, since the objective is different, the strategy of the pricing differs. Now, what are the conditions, preconditions, before I adopt such an objective? I'm listing all those preconditions here. Higher sales volume leads to lower unit cost and higher long-term profits. Friends, we are not here concerned with short-term profits, but we are saying more the sales volume, lower would be the unit cost of the production, and that in the long run will bring me profits. There should be vast potential demand to be tapped at lower price. At the same time, I need to have sufficient plant capacity and distribution channel support. So, the timing becomes very, very important, that in the short run, I should be able to produce more and distribute widely in that short span of time. Lower price would actually discourage actual customers and potential competition. Now, understand this aspect. When I reduce the price and bring it bare minimum at lowest possible profitability levels, that would send very strong signals to my present and future competitors, because the attractiveness of the market immediately falls due to the lower profitability, and this becomes a deterrence to my future competitors, those who want to enter into this market. One more aspect. When a firm goes for this kind of maximum market share and faster expansion strategy, the product has to be defect free. If imagine there is a defect in the product and you go for wider distribution in the short span, it would actually create a havoc in the market, and the firm will not be able to recover from this setback in the long term. One aspect is again important, and that aspect is the product should be capable of prone to adoption, quicker adoptions by the potential customers. There are many technology oriented products where the adoption of the product itself takes little longer time. Say for example, you want to go for ERP softwares, and there is lot of training part involved, adoption part involved, and in such situations, the customer may not be able to adopt it that quickly. Now, in this case, you will have to check, you will have to verify and ascertain whether your product has that capacity. Can it be adopted very quickly by the potential customers? Then only such firms go for this kind of pricing objective. Next objective is maximum market skimming. Here, my intention is to maximize my profits in the short term, in the long run. So, when I'm coming with a new product, an innovative product, I will try to set the prices at a higher level. Now, naturally, my profits would go up, but at the same time, not all my potential customers would be able to afford this product, and I'm okay with that. So, I would say there are 100 customers, and at least 10 of them would be willing to buy this novel product, new product, at this high price. So, though the sales volume is lower, my profitability tremendously goes up, and I will make it exclusive product. I will connote high image around that product, an up-end premium product, and it would be affordable, accessible, available only to those customers who are elite classes, and that way I'll be able to project my product as an up-end thing. Over a period of time, as the technology changes, I will slowly reduce the prices and make this product available to wider customer base. And slowly this product will spread across the entire market, but the prices will keep on falling. Friends, you must have noticed this kind of strategies when you deal with technology products. If you see what is the latest configuration of a television today and what is the next generation television, you will understand there is a vast price difference, and the new generation television only a few people can afford. But over a period of time, the same product maybe in another few years would be available to each one of us. This is exactly the same strategy that the company, the firm is trying to skim the market, keeping prices high in the beginning and then slowly bringing them down so that the profits are maximized. This helps the firm in long-term development of the market by creating a prestige image. And in case of innovation, it also leads to open invitation to competitors. Understand this aspect. If I keep prices too high, and if the profit margin is very big, that would be an invitation to the competition that this is an attractive market and you may come in. But this kind of strategy, that over a period you reduce the prices and make it available to each one of us, reasonably keeps the competition away from that market. Let us have a look at this another objective. The objective here is product quality leadership. My objective is not to make profits. My objective is not to make it available to masses, but I want to establish a benchmark as far as quality is concerned. So the objective is to establish quality leadership. Each one in the market, whether he's a potential customer or not, should be able to perceive my product as the best in the class product. Brands characterized by high level of perceived quality, taste and status, with prices high enough not to be out of customer's reach, is the key of this objective. And you can think of variety of brands like Mercedes, BMW, Cafe Coffee Day and Taj Hotels. You must have wondered many times what makes these firms keep their prices so high that they are beyond the reach of a common individual. The strategy is to establish or to connote a quality leadership to the target customers. Dear friends, you will easily realize that depending on the objective, the price point where it would be set on the line we just discussed, that point would change based on what objective the company is trying to pursue. Apart from these standardized objectives, there could be few other objectives as well. We should not ignore those objectives. Let us have a look at this objective. The first objective is the market share. Whether a firm wants to gain market share or it wants to yield market share, lose market share. In a popular perception, popular assumptions, one would understand that gaining market share is fine. A firm would always be interested in expanding and having more and more market share. But there is something called as optimum market share. You try to increase your market share to a certain point, beyond which it would be little unprofitable for you to expand the market. So the curve usually looks like a U curve, inverted U. And you can increase your market share to a certain point, and beyond that, if the market share increases, the profitability actually falls. So if a firm decides that I will not like to increase my market share beyond a certain point, it would like to yield its market share. So there are instances where a firm wants to gain market share, increase market share. There are instances when a firm wants to give away the market share. Another situation. Imagine that a firm is a market leader and it has very good market share, and there are few competitors even not comparable to the firm in the same market. Now, when the hour of crisis takes place, the demand in the market falls. One of the competitor with an objective of survival may try to price its products even below the cost. Now that brings a great trouble even for the market leader. If you reduce your price below the cost, naturally you attract more customers and that firm tries to gain market share. Now, even if the price in the market falls, the average price in the market falls by 1 rupee, you will understand a firm with market share of 60% will lose by 60 rupees. And to avoid that situation, a market leader may deliberately give away certain customers to such a firm which is trying to pursue the objective of survival. So, what is the objective of the firm as far as market share is concerned, whether it wants to gain market share or lose market share, that becomes an important aspect as far as these other objectives are concerned. There could be a situation that the competitors are to be discouraged. When a firm comes to know through press announcements that a certain firm is trying to enter into this market, a firm may temporarily reduce the prices and bring it to such a level where, unless you have a certain production volume and sales volume, you cannot afford pricing your products at that price point, and it becomes a deterrence to the future entrants. There could be another objective, and that objective is pricing high to avoid driving less competitive players, the way we discuss. In the marketplace, the market leader will have the responsibility to maintain peace and harmony in the entire marketplace, because better profits could be fetched only in the situation of pace where there is no face to face head on kind of competition. And therefore, to protect less competitive firms, non-performing firms, so that no price war starts, the market leader may decide on the pricing strategy, this being treated as an objective. Friends, in this module, we have seen variety of the objectives which are behind setting the prices. We will like to continue with the next objectives, next topics in the next module. So, thank you so much, and we will meet again in the next module, that is third module on